The Venture Brothers is a cartoon about a lot of things. The go-to is it's a show about failure, but I would say it's about abuse and emotional neglect and the many failures of masculinity and the horrible reality of lives we romanticize culturally. The actuality of these cultural myths, how awful they would be if made real.
The only people I get to hang out with are grown-ups. The only time I get to leave the compound is to go someplace creepy like the Bermuda Triangle. And then I get kidnapped by grown-ups.
And what it means to suffer and to have no control over your life, and to have your dignity taken from you, and to make horrible mistakes and hurt people, and then go on living. To keep living. I know BoJack Horseman is described similarly, and I like BoJack alright, but I like The Venture Brothers more, and it's a very different show. It's not just a show about failure. It's about how life is failure, life is suffering, life is comprised of letdowns and indignities. And the brutality of the show, the sometimes baseness of it.
I also heard that he sliced off a kid's hand and ate it. Yeah, it was that big-headed guy that operated on your balls, Dean.
Hank!
More often than not, lends it an uncommon honesty. I can't think of a more sincere TV show, which if you've seen it, is kind of a funny thing to say. Plot-wise, it's a show about a pair of twins and their former Jonny Quest-esque boy adventurer dad and his bodyguard.
For a minute there, I thought you were gonna do your killer hand thing.
So did I.
And his arch supervillain rival and his dead super scientist father, whose shadow he can never get out from under.
Do not call out to your father to save you. He is the one who tied you up and buried your dreams in this tomb. He commands these creatures of the dark. Fear, self-loathing, stinking, sinking, and dilly-dallying.
And the world that these people live in. It's a world of super scientists and supervillains and mercenaries and government secret agents and so on. And it's like the truest thing you'll ever see out of fiction, out of TV, movies, books, whatever. I have never seen the truth of the frustration and the misery of existing, especially existing and experiencing trauma, the way it's portrayed on this show. I have never in my life seen a truer and more enjoyable expression in fictional entertainment of human misery.
Remember, Rusty, in here I'm your doctor, not your father. Now, let's get back to it, shall we? You were telling me how you're ungrateful for all the opportunities your father's given you, and you blame me for all your problems.
Dr. Venture, super scientist and former boy adventurer, is a miserable person.
So you can see why I've been reluctant to go back into therapy.
He's not the main character per se, but he is the character at the center of everything else, kind of the anchor that ties all the other aspects of the show together. And he's not a good person, but he's not a good person the way Walter White is, the way all these cable prestige TV morally ambiguous middle-aged white men are. You're never in danger of thinking he's cool or thinking he's doing the right thing. He's pathetic. And there's a lot of surface-level parody humor derived from how deluded and how pathetic he is initially. But over time, the show digs into his character and why he is the way he is, and just how awful celebrity and hero worship are.
So I can see why he's your best friend. I mean,
he's not my best friend. I just work with him.
And live with him and do everything with him. That's best friends.
Maybe. I always thought of Rusty as my best friend.
What? You know what, White? You are a star.
What?
Yeah, you have the greatest friend in the world, and because he's not famous, you don't care. You should be ashamed of yourself.
Rusty and I went to school together. We were inseparable.
Star.
And the difference between a life lived and a life perceived on television, and what would drive people to act the way they do in superhero shows, again, the reality of that kind of universe as populated by real human beings.
Brock and the boys are still trapped, probably dead by now.
We must help them!
No, duh. I have a zero-point magnet somewhere around here that'll take those pyramid walls down in a jiff, so thanks for nothing.
Pyramid?
Yeah, we were trapped in a pyramid. Some stupid cult made a time machine.
What pyramid cult?
And, without getting into spoilers, how a person's cruelty and selfishness can have very far-reaching consequences. Sometimes Dr. Venture's, but often from other characters. But the show also celebrates small victories and small joys all the time, and explores how you find meaning in life in spite of suffering, and how through accepting the horrible circumstances of your weird life, I mean, what else can you do? You can get through it, and it's really funny.
Who is Hector Molina? And why do they keep sending me his junk mail?
Bill, final notice. Oh, June 6, 2003. I really gotta get my together.
Without the Venture Brothers, Stricci movies and Critical Bits wouldn't exist in the forms they exist now, or wouldn't exist at all. And I know I would be a different person if I had never gotten into the Venture Brothers and been aware of the circumstances of its creation. Of first one person, then two people.
Hello viewers, I'm Doc Hammer.
And I'm Jackson Public.
We're from the Venture Brothers.
We made it up.
Won't you please join us for a very special Venture Brothers episode, tackling some of today's hottest teen issues, like teen swearing.
And teen action.
And Tina Turner.
Who may be second only to, like, David Lynch and Mark Frost, are at the top of their field as far as getting their specific vision onto television and through that making something so weird and brutal and upsetting and uncompromising and hysterically funny and depressing, then touching, then mean and funny again. And in later seasons, gorgeous. Like, especially later on, the backgrounds, the production design, the blocking with characters, it's just... It's a stunning looking show on top of being written so well and performed so well.
The obsession starts. The darkness. A man can do terrible things when he's lost his way. Terrible things.
A lot of early Venture Brothers throws around the words gay and retarded a lot, and there's some homophobic and transphobic stuff, and if you're put off by that or other offensive content in the show, then fair. It's worth giving a warning about, and I'm not trying to make anyone watch a show they'd find upsetting. But I never once felt it was trying to be deliberately offensive. It's more presenting this world with these people, not ever in an edgy way, but in an honest way, and they're immature, sometimes cruel, sometimes bigoted or ignorant people. And a lot of it is cleaned up as the show goes along, though on rewatch, not as fast as I would have hoped, or not as fast as I, like, remembered it being. It goes, that stuff is in the show for a while. And I'm not saying it's perfect representation, but the show goes some interesting places with disabled characters and gay male characters specifically, and has a huge and very intense queer fan base, which I would include myself in. I already really liked the Venture Brothers and had for years and years, and earlier this year I finally caught up on season 6 and 7 and was completely blown away. Hannibal was my favorite TV show, and after watching the Blue Morpho arc of the Venture Brothers, I was just like, wow, this is it. What can compete with this? Nothing. This is so fun and terrifying and funny and deeply sad. It's not like, oh, I'm crying at this tearjerker sad. It's like, oh, this is tragic on a level I feel in my soul. I feel this as a human being. While also being weird and gross and pulpy and referential and payoff after years and years of buildup. Venture Brothers is what you get when a medium self-actualizes. I have multiple projects in the works to go into the show's history and analyze it, but in very brief here, Jackson Public was a storyboard artist and a comic artist, and he came up with the show and pitched it and got his friend Doc Hammer involved to help him. And they've written almost every single episode, and I think Hammer edits the show, and Public directs it, and they voiced most of the cast. And it's been on 16 years with only 7 seasons because of how much work they put in individually and how meticulous the production of it is. I'd highly recommend the art book, which has in-depth sections on the conception and history of every episode through season 6 and is like 375 pages long. I'm gonna be more active than I usually am with this sort of situation in trying to get the show uncancelled. I don't know how much online petitions ever do, but I'll sign them, I'm gonna write letters and mail them, I'm gonna keep tweeting depressing tweets about how upset I am, whatever. And I've read HBO Max maybe picking up the show, but I also read a bunch about how Hannibal was gonna be picked up by a streaming service when it got canceled, and that was 5 years ago, and I'm still waiting. If right after I put this video up, it is announced that The Venture Brothers is no longer canceled and will be taken care of by HBO, then like, stellar! I will be elated. The Venture Brothers is just such a perfect articulation of what it means to be human. Like, I think of Ikiru, and I think of the 400 Blows as these sweet, moving works on, you know, these works on humanity, or like Bicycle Thieves or something. And I think through its darkness and its cruelty and its crassness, along with the earned, genuine, sweet moments, Venture Brothers makes me feel the same way. And it's like these two New York art weirdos doing cartoon voices together.
We have two voices that we do that are almost the same voice. There's a guy from the Council of 13, the one who speaks like this. And then he does Ghost Robot. And they're really long, horrible voices that I want to do a whole episode that is just
those two guys,
those two guys talking.
Yeah.
Yeah, and just excruciate everybody around them not having a good time.
Making references to bands I've never heard of, that I especially never heard of when I was 13 when the show started.
We've been trying to get into an episode since day one, and it's not even funny. It's
really not going to be funny with all this
You guys won't even, you won't like it, but we want Hank to go, stop wasting all my time. Which is like the world.
Wasting all my time.
That's good.
Yeah. Little Miss Can't Be Wrong, but it's from a Cars song, and it's just...
I like that song.
I just think it'd be so funny if Hank, for some reason, knows a Cars song. Because he has this, like, weird recollection of crap that never happened to him.
And they kill clean. Don't let dames get in the way.
Honestly, Hank, where do you pick that stuff up? I never see you read.
It's weird, right?
It's like your channel's dead crazy people.
You think it's a cry for help?
I'm around 30 now, and it's been a part of my brain for that long. Part of how I draw and how I look at visual art. And even more than that, an inspiration to me creatively overall. Their work showed me that something so unique and so special and so dense and sprawling and so unconcerned with popular appeal, some of the show is just cruel and revolting, one of the main cast is a pedophile, could exist. And it inspired me. A lot. I never get a lot of views on my YouTube channel, but I do make what I want to make with little regard to views, and I'm really proud of that. And Doc Hammer and Jackson Public and their whole attitude towards the art they make is a big reason for that, even if I make dumb video essays and not an Adult Swim cartoon. I mean, coincidentally, I just quoted Hammer in a video I put out last month, the comedy one. The show has been a creative influence on me, and an influence on me as a person since before I became an adult. A long time. It's two art weirdos who loved comics and loved movies and loved music and had this story they wanted to tell, and they told it until, because capitalism has a stranglehold on any art being made in the country I live in, I guess it was no longer profitable enough, just like Hannibal wasn't. I don't know. I don't know the circumstances of its cancellation. I hope something happens and they can continue. If you can do something to help make that happen, please do. If you have Hulu, the whole show is on Hulu. First season is a little rough, but by 2 or 3 it picks up a lot, and by 4 and 5 it's really, really good, and by 6 and 7 it's transcendent. Specifically, like I said, the Blue Morpho arc, it's like a 3-episode arc, and I think after that, the Monarch, who is like Dr. Venture's rival, I had always liked that character, but after that I think he became my favorite character, and everything that happens in it is just incredible. Also, some of what I said in the intro to this video about the characters' changes as the show goes on, I know that. Please don't be a pedant in the comments. I said what I said to avoid spoiling people. Speaking of spoilers, here's part of a clip I thought was really nice that Kim Plume tweeted to close out. It's a song Public and Hammer wanted to use for the ending of a season 3 episode but weren't able to get the rights to, and Plume edited music over the clip. I think I saw it before when he had initially tweeted it out a while ago, but he tweeted it again after the cancellation. And I've just been, like, sitting here watching it over and over and getting emotional. The song is Not the First Time by Neil Innes. The episode is The Invisible Hand of Fate. And here it is.
Dismissed, Samson!
What about the kid?
What, do you want to adopt him? I said take it on the arches! PsyOps needs guinea pigs for their memory wipe project, okay? So unlike you, he still works here.